wealth management industry and wealth management as a science has really evolved over the last few years, so much so that there are now very scientific, progressive, and bespoke solutions that are available for HNIs. It's going to be our endeavor this evening to introduce you to some of these solutions and to actually take you through how you can implement some of them with your own wealth management strategy. So with me this evening is Feroze Azeez. He's a deputy CEO of AnandRathi Financial Services. So let me get started and invite Feroze Azeez.
So we discovered there were two different ways of managing wealth. There were two distinctly different methods of managing money. And we realized that one of them, which is so not so popular, is more profitable. And the other method is very popular, but lesser profitable. So method one says, what's the opinion? Form an opinion, buy products which benefit from this opinion. If you think real estate will do well, then go buy some apartments or land parcels from real estate developers or by yourself and create a portfolio of it and see where it takes you. This is method one. The problem with method one is, over the long journey of 10, 15, 20 years, you're collecting products from different people of opinions which changed. Opinions are the most dynamic thing, right? What happened 6 months back? It's doom and gloom. Now that the country has a good mandate, people are more courageous. Opinions change. If I attach my wealth to something which is so fluid, I'll be pulled from all directions. And after 10 years, when I see my portfolio, I have so many products which are not relevant today. Method two says, the lesser popular method where treasuries follow this method two, says that forget the opinion, let's go with the objective. Second step should be strategy. Choose a strategy to meet that objective. Third step is to implement the strategy. Put blinders and implement your strategy. And then monitor whether you're going closer to your objective or going away from it. So objective becomes the kingpin.
I must admit that I've heard Feroze speak about this a couple of times before, but I never tire of hearing about it because each time I hear it, it reinforces in me the need to implement a lot of what has been spoken about. You told all of us about these objectives, right? I mean, what are the elements, right, of wealth management? How do you formulate this strategy?
The three most important things we need to have clarity on so that if every one of us have the clarity, we will come to the same conclusions or create our own strategies. One is you have to get asset class views. You need to have what are the views on the asset classes. That helps you devise a strategy, contemporary asset class views. Product choices. There are 21 types of products possible, out of which, to my mind, 80-90% of the products are not required. And you need to know what not to do more than so product selection. And then what is your risk mitigation strategy? What are the types of risks? What are the risk measures you will use for those types of risks? Mathematical measures. And how do you bring them down into acceptable limits? So what I'm trying to say is if you've got your risk mitigation strategy, your limit set, your product choices, product vehicle choices, and your asset choices correct, then you have a strategy which can be formulated, which has a propensity, higher propensity to meet success, not a certainty though.
Yeah. I know because, in our business, we always think that it's a business of delivering returns, while in reality, it has always been a business of managing risk, right? So let's talk about this risk mitigation a little bit more. How do you go about managing your risk? Which is the best way to do it? I mean, does insurance form a part of it? What's your experience?
So first we have to write down 3-4 risks. One is price risk. Price risk matlab market upar chali gayi, niche chali gayi, right? That's price risk. So first you have to see which are the, there are several types of risks, but three very important risks for each one of us when you're investing is one is price risk, market ka utar chadha. Dusra risk is credit risk. Kisi ko udhar diya aur leke bhaag gaya. Yeah, he doesn't have the capability. He is insolvent or the company is insolvent and can't pay it back. That's called credit risk. The third is liquidity risk, right? Because in a dynamic world, you have to have method to change your strategy, liquidity risk. And the fourth is longevity risk, by which I mean this is globally one of the biggest risks. Longevity risk in the sense, what if I outlive my money? Or if I live too short and my dependents don't have enough money to take care of all the liabilities and their life. So for an HNI, this risk over a period comes down. So longevity risk is basically either you live too short and you leave behind financial trauma along with emotional trauma. That's where insurance comes, life insurance. As you go up in the pyramid, on the top end of the pyramid, life insurance has lesser and lesser relevance. The other insurance is the health insurance, because medical inflation is supposed to shoot through the roof, because India has a very low medical cost globally compared. So health insurance has relevance. Having a 2 crore health cover, saying that if I get hospitalized, I should not have a dent. So four risks. The first three which I mentioned are risk with respect to your investments. Insurance, like you mentioned, has two risks. One is life, the other is health. Health is to do with medical expenses. But if they shoot through the roof, everybody wants sophisticated medical care. So can you protect yourself so that you get the best of medical care without impacting your investments? So healthcare, health insurance has relevance. Life insurance doesn't have. Life insurance should be only taken if your liabilities exceed assets. This gap should be life insurance. अगर आपके पास 10 करोड़ का उधार है, 5 करोड़ पड़े हुए हैं, तो ये 5 करोड़ तो आपके गैप मीट करने के लिए इंश्योरेंस की जरूरत पड़ती है. इफ मोस्ट ऑफ द क्लाइंट्स आई मीट, देयर एसेट्स आर हियर एंड देयर लायबिलिटीज एंड गोल्स आर हियर, सो दे हैव ऑलरेडी सुपरसीडेड, सो स्पेंडिंग मनी ऑन इंश्योरेंस माइट नॉट बी द बेस्ट थिंग.
ओके, यू स्पोक अबाउट यू नो हाउ वी डोंट क्वांटिफाई रिस्क, राइट? वी जस्ट टॉक अबाउट इट, इट्स हाई और इट्स लो और इट्स नॉट देयर और व्हाटएवर. हाउ डू यू प्रपोज वी क्वांटिफाई इट? What's the measure of risk?
Okay, that's, of course, it's a long subject. Let me try to touch upon. You have to, market risk has several measures. The best measure is a simple measure, but sounds more complex than it is. That's why I'm giving you my disclaimer before I use the word. So market risk can be measured using standard deviation. Standard deviation. Bhari barkam shabd hai, but bada saral hai. Okay. What do you mean by standard deviation? Any time when a person throws a variable at me, not a constant. If you put an FD with some of the bank, one any of the bank, and if the bank tells you 8%, will you get 8.1 or 7.9? No, you will get exactly 8. That's a constant. But when I was, during my monologue, telling you 15%, that was not a constant. That was a variable. There will be no year in the next 10 years where you will second decimal get 15%. So every time somebody throws a variable, the next obvious question which should come to our minds is, how much is the variance possible? So standard deviation helps you measure the variation possible. Right? Very simple. Right? If it is a constant, no problem. If it is a variable, then you should definitely ask me this question. Feroze, tu 15 keh to raha hai. Kitna ऊपर नीचे हो सकता है, कितना बड़ा झूला खिलाएगा तो मुझे, वो स्टैंडर्ड डिविएशन से पता लगता है.
ओवर द लास्ट फ्यू वीक्स एंड मंथ्स, दैट्स अ वर्ड दैट हैज कम इनटू कॉमन पार्लेंस एंड अ लॉट मोर पीपल नो अबाउट यू नो व्हाई डिफॉल्ट्स आर इंपैक्टिंग देम देयर पोर्टफोलियोज. वन ऑफ कोर्स इज ट्रिप ए कंपनी गोइंग बैड, बट यू नो से इन अ व्हीकल लाइक अ पीएमएस, ओके, देयर इज अ लॉट ऑफ इन्वेस्टमेंट्स दैट इज मेड. Not all of it is triple A. Not all of it is, in fact, even double A. There's a lot of what some people are now beginning to question is very questionable investments, right? A large portion of it could be in real estate, which, as we know now, is in trouble, as well. Say something like an FMP. So since April, we've seen that a lot of the fixed maturity plans, which should have matured on a date, they didn't give back the full monies to investors, right? In one case, principal didn't come back. In one, there was a rollover that took place. How do things like these fit into a person's portfolio or their asset allocation? I mean, when they're looking at putting money, given the recent events, what do they do now with their asset allocation?
Okay, so debt and real estate are a very large part of Indian assets. So debt, when you put money in debt funds, you will have to measure what are the total number of bonds. Now, for example, there are 8 debt funds in my portfolio. I would check what are the total number of bonds I have in effect lent to. That should always exceed 200. So how many bonds are there in your debt portfolio? See, if you have bought 10 AAA rated funds, you are very happy that you've bought 10 AAA rated funds, but the money is converging back into the same 38 companies and its group companies. But sometimes credit risk funds are lower on risk than a AAA rated fund. Why did such a carnage happen in the debt market? Because both the companies which are now in question, IL and FS, was a AAA rated company. DHFL was a AAA rated company. So point one, your debt strategy, which is your product strategy, should be to buy debt funds such that you at least have 200 companies you have lent to, point one. Point two, the top 20 companies out of those 200 should not exceed more than 2% of the money in them. So even if the top company goes default, 2% of your money can be at risk. So you have to make sure that you learn from the mistake and check the number of bonds which are there in your mutual fund. So, Sumera said something very contemporary. A large asset management company came to the rescue of some investors when there was a default. They bought the paper. Unhone apne profit se wo bond khareed liya aur investor ko paise de diye. So there is a learning there, and this was one of the learnings which I had implemented. Always buy debt funds from the largest companies and very, very profitable companies. Agar unch neech hoti hai, to asset management company uses its reserves, and it has happened 3 times in India, to bail out the investor. So always buy big asset management company, chota fund. So that if there is a default also, if there is a 30 crore default, a big AMC will not, wo apna naam badnaam nahi karegi, wo 30 crore write-off le legi. So big AMC, small funds, well diversified, is a and a credit risk measure beyond rating will keep your debt money safe, because debt ka kaam hi hai safety. Udhar bhi risk aa jaye, to fir main equity mein kyun na rahun?
Let's talk about where to invest then, right? Now globally things are looking a little on shaky ground. So there's a lot for the market to deal with. There's a budget that's coming up. Where's the scope now for investment?
Of course, there are several risks. There are risk mitigants also. That's the point. Now we measure risk, and if it is not to our satisfaction, I have to do something. What is that? Yeah, one instrument which we have been using during times where you feel very, very scared as an advisor also is LEAPS. An instrument which has been available in India for the last 11 years, 28th February 2008, NSE introduced LEAPS in India. What is LEAP? LEAP is nothing but an insurance on the market. If somebody told me that I will protect your downside, don't pay me anything today. Don't pay me anything today. But if there are profits made, if you make profits, are you ready to give away 20% of the profits and keep the 80% profit? Then toh everybody says, yeah, man. So the point I'm trying to make is you can also hedge your downsides by not even paying anything today. You can hedge your downsides by only committing 20% of your profits and keep the 80 with yourself. People say, Feroze, kon hai ye pagal jo 20% ke profit leke puri downside le lega? It is possible on a given working day for any amount can be done. Reasonable amount can be done. So it is for Nifty, like I said. So it's a Nifty. So if my strategy has mutual funds, large cap mutual funds, then Nifty is a good proxy to hedge a mutual fund. If you want to hedge 10 stocks, they might not have a lot of correlation to Nifty.
Some questions.
My question to you is, you mentioned about there are 200 companies you should invest in, you know, when you see the mutual funds. Out of that, 20 companies, the top companies only form part of 2%. So what happens to the balance 180 companies? Do you think that they will not go down and compared to 20 top companies which are AAA rated?
If you buy a mutual fund portfolio, step one, check how many companies we have. You should buy a portfolio such that you have at least 180, 200 companies in the portfolio. The top 20, not in terms of rating, top 20 in terms of how much of my money is in them. Right? Out of the, if my 100 rupees is distributed amongst 200 companies, if all were distributed equally, how much would each of them have? 0.5%? But it is not equally distributed. So the top 20 exposures, not top 20 strongest companies, top 20 जिसमें मेरे पैसे सबसे ज्यादा हैं, उस पे तो लेंस थोड़ा ज्यादा मैग्नीफाइंग ग्लास रखना पड़ेगा उस पे, तो वो 20 कंपनी की, वो 20 कंपनियों में भी 2-2% से ज्यादा नहीं होना चाहिए.
Each. A common investor thinks that buying a PMS with a larger capital trust to you, is it more safer or much more higher return it will give than going in for smaller mutual funds? What is a PMS has an advantage or a disadvantage for a common investor?
There are 9 parameters on which I have looked at data to see whether PMS is better or mutual fund. On all the 9 parameters except one, mutual fund wins. And the 10th objective, which is my objective, PMS wins hands down because it can give me 5% upfront commission. I don't personally invest my money in PMS at all because of their standard deviation. Unki jo swing hai 18 se 20 ki hai. If I have a target on my entire money of 8 risk, if I put something of 20, then it becomes very difficult for me to keep my risk on my overall balance sheet simit. That's why no PMS. And in fact, after April 1st, 2018, PMS ki relevance khatam ho gayi hai mere hisab se, because SEBI introduced one specific category which competes with PMS only. Okay? PMS, why do people buy PMSs? Because mutual funds have 50-50 shares. Anybody who sells or buys a PMS thinks that it's a smaller portfolio concentrated across 15 stocks, 20 stocks. SEBI actually on 1st of April introduced another category in the mutual fund space which is called focused equity. People don't know, people don't speak. Focused equity in the mutual fund category will not have more than 25 stocks ever. So today in a mutual fund, there is one fund, Mrinal Singh, who is the fund manager of ICICI, manages a mutual fund which is in the focused category ICICI with 13 stocks. If I can get Mrinal Singh, who is one of the best fund managers in the country, manage a 13 stock portfolio for me, then I don't need the PMS because taxation is better. Concentration, which was the biggest merit of a PMS, is now available on the mutual fund platform. So one of the funds which I recommend out of the 8 is a focused fund, which is a good one.
How you differentiate wealth management for senior citizen in terms of wealth and time frame?
The conventional mindset says that as age progresses, you have lesser risk to take and more liquidity to have. But I think there are two kinds of people. There are sometimes the money is held in the custody of a person. But if he is not going to spend it, I will devise a strategy as per his child's age, not his age. So there are two kinds of people. One, if I have 30 crores and I'm going to spend in the next 10 years only 10 crores. So the 10 crores has to be the strategy of that person who's going to consume it. Optically, he is owning the entire 30 crores, but he's just the custodian of the other 20. So the 20 should be devised on the basis of the actual ultimate beneficiary, and the 10 has to be to the senior citizen, right? So you'll have to, so it's a matter of strategy. That's why each family needs those 4 hours, because generic can only be objectives. So strategy has to be very specific. So there has to be an Excel sheet drawn up. What is your consumption pattern? What is the money if it grew at 14-15%? How much will you be left with? And then whatever is the additional money then you can imagine to spend will be on your child's strategy, according to me. If it is right or wrong, I don't know. But that's what we think, that the person is not going to spend it. So it's not his money. He's just keeping it in his custody. He has earned it. He has it. But it's not him who is the ultimate consumer of that.
You mentioned about structured products and you said the lock-in period was about a year. And is there a difference by way of taxation if it is invested for a period more than a year or beyond 3 years? And if yes, what are they?
So taxation, structured product, taxation is, it becomes long-term after 3 years. So if you redeem it after 1 year, then your taxation is marginal tax rate, which is the highest rate. But there are, Section 73 helps you manage that taxation. So point one, standalone taxation is inefficient if you redeem it after 1 year. You have an option to redeem it. But we also have structured products which have a rollover possibility. So if you don't want the money after 3 years, it automatically pushes your taxation for 7 years. So then your tax liability comes to 12, 13, 14%. So to answer your pointed question, 1 year ke baad tax is very inefficient. 3 years ke baad it is efficient, 20% tax. If you can defer it for another rollover, then it comes down to 13-14% taxation.
I want to ask that what should be the course of action in case of the short term? Like, should we go for the liquid funds?
See,
because
madam,
for the equity and the mutual funds, you have a lock-in period or you have to stay for like 1 year, 2 year or 3 years.
If you have a portfolio parallelly, which you do, I hope, do you have a separate investment portfolio as well other than this park money? Yeah, if you do, then you should look at a liquid fund growth option. So even if you got short-term capital gain, this portfolio can help you mitigate the taxation on the short-term capital gain. So to answer your question, you had an answer in your question itself. Liquid funds are a vehicle for short-term parking. Less than 1 year, 1.5 year also, you can use a liquid fund. Get 7.5%. And if you have another portfolio, then you can make this 7.5% tax-free also. If you smartly manage this extrapolation.
Feroze, thank you. And thanks to all of you for being here and for sharing your time with us.